Yeah, where's my rockers in here? Get them up. That's right. That's right. Sing it. Come on, baby. Don't feel like it should. Hurt so good. All right. I love it. I love it. John Cougar, man. Whatever you do, do not go and watch that video. All right. I was like, whoa, we cannot use any of that. I know some of us, man, some of us hear these songs and they take us back, right? They take us back. Last week we used the song, of course, Oh Child, man, that was a jam. And then some of us hear this song and it takes us back to the times when we were rockers, when we were riding on the back of that motorcycle. Some of you are still doing that and you shouldn't, Troy. But it takes you back, right? It takes you back to a time when you were cool, you know? But some of these jams, and we remember them. Like, we remember some of them, and they bring back memories. And so this summer I said, man, let's do a series where we just do some old school jams. And some of these old school jams are going to be songs you know. Some of these are going to be stories that you know. And they're going to relate real well. And you're going to hear these songs later on. You're going to think, man, I know that relates. I hear that. I hear that so good. I hear that so good. So look at this. Sometimes, look at this. Look, see this leather. Isn't this leather? I had this just sitting in my closet. Man, this is not my leather jacket. And it smells, so like Chris Bowman. Oh. And then today I get the get up on it, you know, I'm like, oh, this is I'm gonna try this bandana on. I look really like a rocker. And then this guy comes around the corner at our retreat and he says, hey, Tupac. Chad, I can work both sides. I'm like, no, rocker, not rapper. Oh my goodness. But see, hey, as we're looking through, and I'm getting like, I'm scorching now. This leather is real. As we're working through these songs, as we're working through some of these jams, like we remember, we're going to hear them in a way now, like I said, that are going to remind us now of some of the things that we're talking about in this series. And the one we're talking about today is how the way that we love one another, sometimes isn't the way that we're used to. Sometimes the way that we've even grown up learning how to love one another is not the way that actually we're called to love one another in Scripture. The way that we're called to actually speak truth into our lives, each other's lives. And so as I'm hearing this song, I'm thinking, man, I'm just thinking, wow. I'm like, this is good stuff, because sometimes when we speak like the church is actually supposed to, the growing church, the church that we call community, when we speak to each other in truth, sometimes it hurts. Sometimes it hurts, but it's good. Sometimes it hurts, but man, it's like, man, that hurts that you're saying that, but that's exactly what I needed to hear. Has anybody ever said that? Well, you know why? It's because that's what we were built. It was built into us by the Spirit for us to speak this way to one another. And when we don't, we actually rob one another. We actually rob one another. We actually are not actually serving one another. We're not actually really having a connection with one another, like we talk about, like, you know, man, connected to God and each other through genuine community. When we say that in the church, when we say that in this church, sometimes that is going to hurt, because it's going to be somebody coming up to you and speaking truth to you. So I know right now some of you are thinking about fishing. So we're going to move through this a little bit. You should have with you, right next to you, man, you have a way you can follow along. There's a bulletins in the back for those that are like wanting to do the paper. I totally love that. There's some in the back. You can work. You can see it online or on our app. Many of you, I didn't know if you knew that we had an app you can follow along with. We've got an app for that too. So we want you to make sure that you check out that. So guys in the back, you guys are going to have to help me on this first page, okay? So when we're looking at truth, let's look at the first point. First point is this. Take a look at it. Truth, when you're going to speak truth to one another, truth always aims at love. Truth always aims at love. Like when you're going to speak truth, like what you know, when you come up and you want to, like someone you know in your community of faith, somebody in your community group, somebody that you know calls themselves a follower of Christ, when you come up and you are going to love them, your truth to them has to be aimed at love first. Like many of us have known so much about Scripture. Like we know, oh man, I know this verse. And you ever go up and you start spouting off verses to somebody about things that they're doing, things that they're living or whatever. And he's like, you're like, I printed off, I Googled this, and I've got a whole list of these scriptures that are going to tell you of the things that you're doing. How well does that go over with you? Now, some of you are sitting there and you're thinking, well, wait, Pastor. No, it's the Word of God. It's the Word of God. Let me tell you where the Word of God started with. The Word of God started with in the beginning, right? God was here with us. And then we go to the New Testament. We're like, okay, in the beginning there was God, right? And then God. So let's start with that. And then we go to the New Testament, and then we know that Emmanuel, God with us. So when we talk about Scripture, we have to first understand that God wanted a relationship with us first before he started spouting out Scriptures. And so when we're looking at, that's why I say it, sometimes the relationships, when we're talking about hurting so good, sometimes our relationships and how we connect with one another, how we call each other out, the truth has to be aimed at love first. Look at this Scripture up on the screen. The purpose, listen to this. This is awesome. The purpose of my instruction, do you hear that? The purpose of the things that I know, the purpose of all of my mighty knowledge, the purpose, he says, of his instruction is that all believers would be filled with what? Someone say, love. Yeah, look at the person next to you and say, love. That's right. Don't get too far with that. All right. Should be filled with love that comes from, listen to this, that comes from a pure heart. Comes from a pure heart, a clear conscience, and a genuine faith. Some of you are like, man, you always talk about genuine community, genuine faith. Why you always talk about that? Because I'm talking about it because it's all in the Bible. And it's right there. And I'm talking about it because, man, this is the type of relationships, these are the type of relationships that we're trying to build. And how do you do that? You have to be willing to love one another hard, even when it's difficult. Be willing to say, man, I'll call out this person. But you call out that person with your knowledge of Scripture, your knowledge of the Bible, instead of your relation to the Bible, it's going to be difficult. It's going to be difficult. So today, listen, here's what we're just talking about this together. We're like, man, how do we really become a community? How do we really be connected in what we call church, in what we call, you know, community group, what we call serving together, what we call in our workplaces? You know, oh, he believes in God. He loves God. He loves Jesus. How do we really be connected to that? We got to really love each other in a way that is not typical to the world, in a way that we're actually having tough conversations. So the second one's this, okay, love. Love, here's what love does, okay? Love points at truth. So when you're loving someone, when you're like, okay, well, I'm going to love someone, what does that look like? When I'm loving someone, where does that point to? Well, first, when you're loving someone, it has to point to something that has truth in it, right? So many of us, we've seen, even in our culture, is that like, there's really not in our culture a hard line between what there is truth and where. And so how does that look when you actually love someone? You know, the Bible, it just says, man, it's impossible to love without knowing God, because God is love. So you've heard me say this before, that, man, when we're talking about loving someone, where do we even get that from? Where do we even get that from? When you're saying, oh, I love her, I love him, I don't know if you say that, but I love him, I love her, you're like, man, he's cool, whatever. You're like, where does that come from? What kind of love? What does that look like? Well, the love you have, when you're going to call someone out and you say, no, I really love them, that love's got to be pointed somewhere. And it's got to point to truth. See, sometimes we love, right? Here's what we do. Sometimes we love with so much like fluff. Like we just love with fluff. It's like, oh, I just want to, you know, hey, I love you. Let's go walk around the mall together. I love you. Let's go look for some shoes. I love you. Let's go hunting together. It's like, oh, these are, oh, no, I'm not. Listen, I love these things. Community, awesome. That's amazing. But sometimes we love with so much fluff that we leave our friends and family wandering in the desert. Like we'll spend hours with them in whatever they're doing, and we don't take the opportunity to actually point them at truth. It's like them being in the desert, honestly. It's like them being in the desert, and you get a call on your phone, and you're like, hey, what's up? How you doing? I'm in the desert, man. Come out to the desert. Come out to the desert. It's hot. I seen a salamander over there. Those are scary. You're like, just come. That's what I would say. You know, no, come out to the desert. And then, you know, then you hear it in their voice. You hear the desperation in their voice. And then you decide, okay, well, no, I can do that. I got gas in my car. I could come out to the desert. And you come out to the desert, and you're happy, and you bring them balloons. And you're like, how you doing? And they're just like, oh, I'm hurting, man. I'm hurting. What's on? You heard it in my voice. You hear it in my voice, like how bad I'm hurting right now. And then we were like, well, here's some balloons. I brought you some balloons, the stars you like. You love the stars because it's all over your Instagram that you love stars, right? Oh, well, yes. Oh, and matter of fact, I knew you were hurting, so I even got a get well sign or a balloon. Stop by the dollar store. Only cost me a dollar. Right? And you bring the balloons and you put them by them and you're like, so I hope that you're doing well. And they're hurting and you see that they're dealing with real sin in their life. And we bring them balloons. Then we leave. And we spend, here's the deal. I think we spend a lot of time seeing the brokenness in those near us, like, and not just from just life that comes at them, but like the sin that they're dealing with. Like we spend a lot of time seeing the brokenness, and we bring them a bundle of balloons. And we say, I love you. And you say, man, this really sucks in the desert. And then we take off. And then here's the thing, is that hard love, like really hard love, will always require speaking the truth. It'll always require, like when someone's like, no, they really love me. No, no, no. If they really love you, then hard love will always require speaking the truth. Or you're just leaving them. I think that you're just leaving them, and I'm just leaving them in the desert, alone, in their sin, and in their death. And you bring them balloons, and you walk off, you drive off down the highway, and they're like, man, balloons. I need something better than that. And you know you have that. We know we have it. And sometimes, man, it requires us like being really clear about this. Right? Remember, okay, how about this? The woman caught in adultery, right? The woman caught in adultery, John 8:10. Okay, woman caught in adultery. This was not her best day. Let's be real, okay? Everybody is around. This woman is brought into the public square, and Jesus is right there. Jesus stands up, and he says to the woman, after he had already said to all of these people, where's your sin, right? Everybody likes this, right? Because it feels fluffy. It does. It kind of feels fluffy, and here's why I say this, is because they were ready to get real angry about sin, and we'll get angry about sin, won't we? We'll get angry about sin to the point of condemnation, in the point of judgment, in the point of, I want to throw rocks at this lady. And then Jesus comes along, of course, and he says, hey, what about you? Where's your sin? You guys, so the one that doesn't have any sin, go ahead and you be the first one that winds up and throws it. Of course, they drop their rocks. And we have seen this and heard this story, and I think sometimes we interpret this in a way that Jesus tolerates sin. And we're good at this sometimes, aren't we? As believers, we stop reading sometimes. Like, we're like, man, I love that right there, that Jesus is just forgives, and he's just like, come on, I got your hand, and then we aren't going to talk anymore about that sin. We're not going to talk anymore about it. Just come here. And we're like, I love me, Jesus. I do, and I do too. But I want to tell you why I love Jesus. It's because he says to her, hey, where are your accusers? Where are these people? Did not even one of them condemn you? No, they're gone. She says, no one's condemned me. And Jesus said, neither do I. Neither do I. And then he says this, the part many of us don't like to hear, go and sin no more. That's hard love, isn't it? Like, your friend shows up, loves you, hugs you, you're crying, you went through, you made some tough decisions, you're like slobbering all over yourself, it's like just a terrible situation. And the friend comes up, they're hugging you, they're loving you, and then they call you out on your sin. How's it feel? It's tough, isn't it? And what if you just knew that friend didn't want to see any more destruction in your life? What if you knew that friend didn't want to see you in wallowing right here in the midst of your struggle and your tears and just feeling that way? Paul writes to the Corinthian church, listen to how he says it. He says, out of much affliction and anguish of heart, I wrote you with many tears, he says. Not so that you would be made sorrowful, not so that you would read this and then you would get angry, or not that you would be upset, not that you would feel like, oh, well, how can he tell me this? Or how can she say this? How could she call me out on what I posted? How could she call me? How could he call me? No, no, no. Paul's like, no. It wasn't that. It wasn't that you would be made sorrowful, but that you might know the love which I have especially for you, is what Paul says. Translation, I called you out on your crap so that you'd know how much I love you. And how many of your friends are saying that to you? How many of your friends are really just saying, man, and some of the stuff and some of the stuff maybe you shouldn't be saying, doing, whatever. And how many of your friends, your brothers or your sisters, especially in Christ, are calling you and calling you out? So that's just another example how love points at truth. And Paul is filled with love, and it compels him to write this hard letter. And he's writing it through tears. You want to know how hard it is? Like, isn't it? You're like, how hard is it? They're jacking up their life. I just call them, No, you try it. Because when you love them and you see that they're broken, it starts to break you too. And you start to feel that. And love speaks the truth personally with solid doctrine. You got to know your stuff. Love speaks the truth with solid doctrine. So we've got to take the example of Jesus. As we're connecting with one another, you're like, why is this important? It's because this is everything, actually, when we're really having real community. Like, when we're really having, like real love for one another, this is everything, because who do you have that will actually speak this truth to you? We've got to take the example of Jesus in confronting sin in each other's lives. He did not accept it. I'm not going to accept the sin. I'm not going to tolerate it. I'm not going to tolerate. Many of us hear that and are like, you're not going to tolerate it. No. We're just not going to live with it. Like, it's not going to have a room in our house. It's not going to be a roommate. I'm not taking it in. I'm not going to tolerate that. We've said this, right? You ever said that to your kids? Just not going to tolerate that. We need to say the same thing about our sin. I'm not going to tolerate it. He was clear. What did he say? Repent and go and sin no more. So what we've fallen on that is like, oh, well, I'm not going to be perfect, right? Well, every time you sin, you repent and become perfect again. Many of us don't want to, like, we're like, oh, no, wait. You're telling me that I can be perfect. Yeah, repent and you're perfect. You are repenting from the blood of the perfect Jesus Christ. Will you sin? You will. But hopefully you'll sin a lot less with the thing you just sinned doing. You see what I'm saying? And why did Jesus say this? Why did he say this to her? Because he loved her and he points her at truth. Next one is this. Love shapes how to speak the truth. Love shapes how to speak the truth. Ephesians 4:15. Instead of all the ways you've seen it, instead of all the ways that you read it, instead of all the ways that you're watching it, instead of all the ways that the examples that maybe that you're getting around you, instead, we will speak the truth in love. Growing in every way more and more like Christ, who is the head of his church. It's like, man, when you're speaking truth, like when you're like, oh, wait, no, I'm going to speak the truth. Guess what has to be happening when you're speaking the truth in love? Because if you're not speaking the truth in love to the person that you love, you don't really love that person. I'm just going to be real clear about that, okay? But when you speak the truth in love, how are you being shaped to even be able to say anything? How is that really even happening without Scripture, without knowing the Word? Like, man, you've gone up to someone, many of you have said this to me. I want to say something to them, I just don't know what to say. I don't know how to say it. You know who else said that? The Apostle Paul. Moses. I don't know how to say it. I don't know what to say. And the same thing happened every time. God said, I will give you the words to say. I will give you the words to say. When you have the word in your life, when you have it over you, when it's in your life, you begin to know how to speak the truth in love. You begin to know how it transforms you. But man, if you don't know the word, if you're not, we talk about this all the time, if you're not in a reading plan, if you're not daily, every other day, whatever, if you're like, you're not saying, man, I need something that will actually teach me in love, how could you ever help each other? How could we ever help each other? What would that really even look like? So speaking the truth in love means this, that we are to grow up in all aspects of the one in Christ. We are to grow up in Christ, right? There's an unloving way to speak truth. We all know that. We kind of seen that. We've seen people that are like really condemning. We see that. Sometimes we hear it and we're like, I don't want, you're not really loving me. Like, we've seen that. We don't like that, I know. But there is a way to speak the truth in love, and that's the way we have to seek. And it's not always a soft way to speak, or Jesus would have been accused of a lack of love with dealing with people, right? But he didn't. He spoke truth, hard truth. So how are we going to, here's the question, I think. How are we going to speak the truth unless we are under the truth we are speaking? How are we going to speak the truth if we're not under the truth we are speaking? Some of you ever been to the gym and you see the personal trainers? Yeah, right? Like a person went in, obviously in flabby nature, went in and said, I got to get some help. And I'm going to go in and I'm going to find me a personal trainer. And you go in and some of you are just at the gym and you see the personal trainer over there and the personal trainer and the person's like, you know, just getting it started and sweating, whatever. And you look at the personal trainer and that personal trainer is probably ripped, right? Like that personal trainer, you look at the personal trainer, you're like, that's what they're going to do. That's what they're going for right there. And some of you are like, I hate that or whatever. You're like, that because you want the personal trainer, right? You want that personal trainer to actually be a good example of what she is teaching you, what she or he knows his stuff. Some of you might have been in the gym and you saw a personal trainer, you're like, they should not be personal training. Where am I right now? $1 a day or whatever, I don't know. But you're like, no, it's like, no. Like we look and we are the same way. It's like, how do we keep ourselves in shape to train, to love one another? Sometimes, man, I think that we as people, and you're like, this is very judgmental, but I think we look at each other and we're like, how should he be being a personal trainer spiritually? And you're like, that's so condemning. Well, we do the same thing when we go to the gym. Why would that person be able to? Because we know that we need to be in shape. And the Bible is what puts us in shape. Finally, last one, truth. Truth shapes how to show love. truth shapes how to show love. So like as we're growing and as we're getting this, like you're reading this, you're like, man, I'm hearing this, I'm following this plan, I'm reading this book, whatever. Like truth begins to shape you in how you actually show love to one another. 1 John 5:2 says this, says, we know we love God's children if we love God and obey his commandments. This is how. So the truth shapes how to show love to one another. And it's not always obvious which are acts of loving, right? So John tells us some truth will help us know if our acts are loving or not. See, we need a test, don't we? We need something that shows whether or not we are actually loving one another. Because if it's really ambiguous or we're getting it from the world, we become confused and we just stop loving. Do you hear that? Unless we have a measurement, unless we have a gauge that knows how to do this, then we just stop it. And we know how that works. Truth shapes how to show love. Like we need a filter, right? We need a filter. We need a filter like brain down through the heart, right? And then rocket ships out of your mouth. I don't know how ever it worked. I would just like, I wish I could invent that. Like, it's like, because we see something that we know in our brains that probably isn't right, either how we're living or while one of our brothers and sisters are living in Christ. And we see it and we want to say some nonsense, don't we? We want to say some stuff and it comes right here and we need a filter. And the filter is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit takes what's in your brain, goes through that Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit's like, nah, you can't say it like that. That ain't gonna work. That's the voice. My Holy Spirit sounds like Will Smith. You have yours, I don't know, whatever you want it to sound like. Mine is Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, all right? And so, like, we need this filter, and this filter is the Holy Spirit. It comes from our brains where we want to say whatever it is, and it's like, no, don't say it. Go back in. And then it goes down to the heart, works out a system, and comes back out our mouth the way that God would want it. See, one truth test for our love is whether we are living out God's word towards other people. Like, you want to know if, like, what's my truth test? What's my truth test? Well, your truth test is whether or not you're living out God's word towards people. In other words, we cannot live and speak separately from the truth of God's will. Do you hear that? We cannot speak separately and live separately from the truth of God's will, because truth shapes how to show love. So this is our prayer, and this is my hope for us, okay? Is that you won't, for one, be a coward. Like the people that are around you that you say that you love and that you care for, now you're like, well, what about people that don't know, go to church, don't know the Bible? Okay, let's stop that, okay? I'm talking about the people that you know call themselves followers of Jesus Christ, the ones who say, I know I love God. And you see this and you say, I know that's not a reflection of Christ. Like, do you have the boldness today? And this is my prayer, that God will cause his love and truth in you to overflow. Like, it's in you. Like, you're getting, you're like hearing it right now. You're like, oh, that scripture. Okay, I got that. And then maybe you're in your reading time. You're like, oh, I got that. Like, oh, I heard that on the radio. Oh, I got that. I love that song. And it's speaking scripture. And it's like in you. And it's overflowing in you. And it's out of your mind. Like, it's overflowing. And like, it's coming out. And you're boom, whoo. You're just gleaming with God's word. And that's my prayer, that God would cause his love and truth to overflow in us in all these ways so that we can be filled with his truth-filled love and love-filled truth. Truth-filled love and love-filled truth. So how does this happen? It has to happen through genuine love for one another. And man, it's just going to be a terrible church when we can't do it. Like if you're totally lost on this message, you're like, oh man, okay, let's go fishing. I just want to go to church. You won't really last in this church. And then you'll won't last in the next church because God has not made his church to be like that. He's made his church to be like Christ. And the Christ we read about is one who loves each other hard. And sometimes it hurts. It hurts. But man, have you ever been called out on something and you get mad? And you're like, I'm not going to talk to that person. Like, whatever, I'm not going to talk to him. And then like, I don't know, a week goes by, maybe for some of you, a year. And you're like, and you feel like such a dumbhole because you're looking back on your life and you're thinking, I unfriended that person, not on Facebook. Like, I really, literally unfriended. Like, you unfriended that person because they spoke truth to you. And you look back on that part of your life where there was destruction. And you say, man, and maybe they come across on your feed and you're like, I remember the times we had, that was fun, fishing at the fishing tournament. And we were sitting there and it was fun. It was great. And then they called me out on my stuff because I was an alcoholic. And I told them, no, I'm not. And then you were a mean drunk to them. And a year later, you're like, they were right. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that your word teaches us not fluff. Father, I pray that we would be bold enough to read through the stories and not stop and say that you're a God who just tolerates our sin. God, no, you're a God who loves us so hard that you would require us to live like Jesus. Because of the destruction that sin brings to our life. God, I pray we would be a bold people to speak to each other, to speak to our other brothers and sisters in Christ in a way that would call them out to their life in Christ. Father, let us be a people that are open to people who love us and will speak truth to us. Let us, Father, be a people that understand that we're not perfect and that we're growing together. Father, let us be bold in that. Father, that's what we need today. In a culture that doesn't have very few real conversations, gosh, we are so fake. We're so full of it. God, I pray we would be a people that would actually have real conversations with one another. In Jesus' name, amen.